It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all for this webinar on digital health solutions. We all know that the world is reeling under the impact of the coronavirus, which has not only exposed the fragility of the health system, but also impacted the economic for the countries. And COVID-19, it has not only demonstrated that public health requires global solutions to build a robust and a responsive health system. But we also know that the heart of the solutions, there'll be multilateral efforts that could leverage the expertise and the experiences of individual nations. Digital health does provide opportunities to accelerate our progress in attaining not only the health and well-being related to sustainable development goals, but specifically also look at the other SDGs. We all know that the fourth IR technologies have been deployed in healthcare and have been extensively started being used, and they are very efficient. They are very effective in healthcare delivery, as well as they are also effective in cost reduction, or you can also say data or information management. But to deliver the potential, I think national and regional digital health initiatives must be guided by a robust strategy that not only integrates the financial, organizational, but also the human and technological resources. Do we see any best practices specifically adopted by the BRICS grouping, which can be shared with other emerging and developing nations? Can you hear me, Dr. Rafael?
Can you hear me, Dr. Rafael?
Yes, no, yes. Sorry, I think your microphone and your camera went down, at least for me. Maybe my connection, sorry.
Shall I repeat the question? I'll just repeat the question.
Yes, please.
I just want to know in brief, what can the BRICS nation do to catalyze a digital transformation in global health?
Okay, thank you very much, Mrs. Sharma, dear members of the panel. One thing to notice is that the Brazilian health digital health strategy is quite new. We have revised our 2015 strategy last year, and so far, it obviously has been hastened by the COVID-19 scenario. And because of that, I'd like to reply your question in two parts. The first one, the digital health strategy itself, and the second one, the challenges we face in terms of implementation and how we are trying to overcome them in Brazil. So in terms of the digital health strategy, it is important to note that Brazil is not, we do have a very peculiar health system, actually have a unified health system comprising, for example, for primary healthcare, nearly 52,000 family health teams all over our territory. We have almost 100,000 health institutions, which makes coordination and overcoming fragmentation a big issue in Brazil, and also equity and access. And this is one of the main reasons why Brazil is heavily investing in digital health, especially in our territory. The inception of this debate in Brazil dates back to 2015, when we had a national plan on information and informatics for health, a e-health strategy, and also a monitoring and evaluation plan. Last year, the WHO has issued a comprehensive digital health strategy and required countries to provide revised digital health plans. And Brazil actually responded to the call by revising its own plan and gathering all the different plans and strategies we have into one singular document and one singular strategy for the whole country. And it is also important to note that we have shared, since we have a unified health system and we are a federation, we have different responsibilities at the union, the 27 states and the 5,500 municipal governments in the country. So it's a huge effort we are actually making. Our new health strategy is a 8-year plan. And it's, as I said, it is in, responding to WHO call to mostly revise the strategies and increase collaboration among countries. And also because of the COVID-19 scenario, we needed to hasten the process. And I'm going to go back to this point in the end of my speech. So in terms of what is different in this new strategy, mostly it's we gravitated from an electronic government rationale to a user-centered approach. This is the main difference. Secondly, we can now, we are making the transition from database and data gathering to the effective use of analytics to the user, the health professionals, physicians, psychologists, and other health professions all over the country, and health managers. And finally, telehealth is an important issue in Brazil, in particular telemedicine. And in terms of preliminary results, this plan is nearly 1 year old, but we already have, let's say, I would say remarkable results in a COVID-19 scenario. The first one is the fact that we have an application which is coordinated by the Ministry of Health. We've been having 500,000 new users in the last 1.5 years. We have reached last month 11 million users, active users, individual users in the app. The immunization COVID-19 immunization campaign is currently being coordinated through this app. We have nearly 15% of the population who has received the first dose, and all the analytics and the data we receive from labs all over Brazil are coordinated inside or in the back end or in the front end of this platform. A second remarkable result is the fact that we have nearly, as I said, 52,000 family health teams, and we were able so far to informatize nearly 70% of the teams. In other words, it means that it makes the data transfer process to the central office in Brasilia is way easier in such a scenario. To finalize my speech, I'd like to call attention to the issue of telemedicine, which is one possible issue among the broader area of telehealth. Brazil has a long-lasting problem in terms of distribution.
Dr. Rafael, if you could briefly wind it up.
Okay, I'll wrap it up. We have a long-lasting problem in Brazil in terms of distribution of physicians in the country. So telemedicine could help a lot in this regard, because we do have enough physicians in Brazil now, according to the WHO standards, but we face nearly two challenges. First, telemedicine does not substitute face-to-face clinical examination. And secondly, the average access to internet per household in Brazil is nearly 50%. So we also have, as the WHO clear states, we also have to consider the inequality and the other social determinants of health and infrastructural problems in a country like our own. So this is pretty much what I had to say for my opening remarks. Thank you very much, Mrs. Shuri.
I think I really like the data-based, data analytics. That's so important, especially when at the times of pandemic. And data and telehealth does have its own negativities or disadvantages than meeting a patient in person. But then that could be put to best use in times like this. Thank you so much, Dr. Rafael. Professor Natalia, if I can have your intervention, please. Yes.
Okay. One more time. Hello, everyone. Now, situation regarding coronavirus in Russia is relatively good, but we cannot now say what we are winners, because it can be changed every time. And now we have, as you know, maybe four vaccines, vector-based vaccines, Sputnik, peptidopitop vaccine, Epivac Corona, light vector-based vaccine, Sputnik Light, and the vaccine based on full-kidded virus, Covivac. All data regarding vaccination about each vaccinated citizen now upload on the permanent basis into the government database, and every body can receive virtual certificate about vaccination after a second dose of vaccine. Now we collect all data about reinfections, about efficiency of vaccination, and big data server, which allow to analyze the situation. We also implement tests for COVID who return for people who return from abroad, and all tests now from returned travelers should be uploaded into the government system. Until they have received negative result, returned travelers cannot move from home or hotel. Now also we have two big data system about all COVID-19 cases. One system belongs to Ministry of Health, other system belongs to Federal Service of Consumer Rights Health Protections Service, Rospotrebnadzor. These two systems includes results about laboratory tests, severity of disease, number of contacts, outcomes, but database of Russian CDC, Rospotrebnadzor, Federal Service of Consumer Rights and Health Protection Service, oriented more to contact tracing, to laboratory tests, and data system of Ministry of Health more oriented to severity of disease, outcomes, etc. All genome sequence now uploaded on one common all Russia system for analysis, mutation, and their geographical distribution. We also upload all positive PCR tests in one system for analysis, big data. And one more, maybe now ongoing achievements, several top-level healthcare establishment in Russia now developing a neural net for big data analysis of computer tomography for assessment in jury of lungs in patients with COVID-19 and to implement differential diagnostic between our lung pathology. This healthcare establishment have plans to combine all data and have big pool of data and to estimate possibility to analyze this data using IT technology and to collaborate on the national, on the international level with our big data database, which now available in our countries. Over. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You, Professor Natalia. I think transparency and availability of the data is very important. And I think you mentioned about the contact tracing. Even if the situation is getting better, but it's always better to continue contact tracing so that the virus does not spread. Thank
yes,
you so much.
Thank you, because we start to use this technology after China experience.
Yes.
And we understand what contact tracing is can lead to good result in keeping in the pandemic.
Yes, thank you, Professor. Now, can I request Dr. Shambhavi for her intervention?
Thank you, Shobha. First of all, thank you for inviting me to participate in this very important dialogue. I just wanted to quickly go over some of the objectives of digital health from an Indian perspective and how BRICS nations can cooperate in this area. The development of digital health tools an important supplement to health service outreach, addressing informational asymmetry and improving health outcomes. Digital health has been widely practiced in many countries to sustain medical consultations, even as COVID-19 has created this atmosphere where patients are confined to their homes. And this has been perceived as a very effective mechanism to decrease informational asymmetry when it comes to finding information on health services. However, as Professor Rafael also noted, this is not a substitute for poor health infrastructure and resources, and it can work best as a supplementary factor for capacity building. From an Indian point of view, obviously, there's plenty of avenues to adopt digital health tools. And I think this was underscored by the articulation of the National Data Health Mission strategy in 2020. And just building on that, we have electronic health records, which when maintained in an interoperable manner, as envisioned under India's data empowerment and protection architecture, can help reduce diagnostic costs and ease access to health history for medical professionals. This can then be the basis for a health information exchange, allowing telemedicine then to be used to consult and advise between patients and doctor or amongst doctors from across the country and really across the BRICS nations as well. And then COVID-19 has obviously highlighted the importance of the telemedicine services, and I won't reiterate that again. In addition, we have diagnostic tools such as wearables that can enable real-time monitoring of patient health data, leading to more effective decision-making by medical professionals. And at a population level, the analysis of all of this data can feed into policy responses through health programs that are tailored to the health needs of the target population. A low-hanging fruit for this really for us is point-of-care diagnostics and screening for early detection of diseases and early intervention, which would save not only lives, but also reduce the demand for tertiary healthcare and costs of intensive treatments. And again, collected on a population level data, we could hopefully be able to then pick up infectious disease outbreaks earlier and underpin a health response to prevent further spread. And such preventive strategies would provide relief to strained health resources and allow their effective use, even as we keep on building up more capacity, which is something we just have to do. The chief challenges, obviously, in the Indian context, and where I think we can have shared learning with the other BRICS nations, is the fact that we also have the digital divide that Professor Rafael spoke about. We need to have sustained investment in health infrastructure, standardized medical reporting. We obviously need that Data Protection Act that has been going around the halls of Parliament for a few years now. We need to find a mechanism to deter cybersecurity threats. And the strengthening of a health regulator, which is overseeing digital health tools to build trust and increase adoption of them. So similar to what Professor Rafael said, we have half of India's population which lacks internet access. And even if they get online, according to the survey on social consumption on education in India, only 20% of Indians know how to use digital services. So that training would be required. We have capacity deficit of beds, doctors, nurses, which definitely needs to be improved. Finally, we also need to have that strong regulator. Where do I think BRICS nations can cooperate in this? I think as COVID-19 has demonstrated, public health is not about national health only. Countries must cooperate to balance apparent mismatches of supply and demand for healthcare expertise and infrastructure. This is a global issue and has to be treated through global cooperation. And standardizing medical data in the form of digitized inventories would be one key step in achieving this cooperation. Secondly, we have to cooperate in research and innovation of new digital health tools, where shared funding, knowledge, and research across the BRICS nations to create novel tools can help counter some of the challenges that digital health innovation faces. For trialing new technologies, the idea of regulatory sandboxes, a concept borrowed from fintech, where innovators can conduct live experiments in a controlled environment under a regulator's supervision, may be useful. The NDHM actually envisions a digital health sandbox in a very similar fashion. And successful implementation of digital health therefore depends on an ecosystem that fosters not only innovation, but also trust and adequate formulation of appropriate policies to govern digital health. And in this area too, I think governments across the BRICS nations can learn from each other and work together to develop effective policy. And finally, regulation could be modified for fast-tracking approvals for digital health tools which have been developed and approved across the BRICS nations, thereby removing some of the barriers for creating more tools. The COVID-19 outbreak has demonstrated the urgency of increased multilateral cooperation to protect global health interests. And no country can be safe unless all countries have adequate, accessible, and affordable healthcare. And in this regard, I think it is in the national and global interest for BRICS countries to use this opportunity to collaborate and lead the way in creating world-class products and services and policies that govern digital health to the benefit of all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shambhavi. I think you set the objectives very right. And yes, we need to revolutionize digital health, to achieve higher standards of health and access to medicines, as well as protect the health and well-being of the population. But at the same time, we also need to look into the fact that it is not a substitute, as you rightly said. It's supplementary, but there are gaps which need to be overcome to be able to achieve how our digital health could be achieved to its full potential, to how it could be utilized to its full potential. I totally agree with you. Thank you. Professor Liu, if we can have your intervention, please.
Okay. Thank you. I'm Liu Xiaoyun, a professor in health system research from Peking University, China. It's my great pleasure to join the panel to discuss the digital health solutions in the COVID-19 pandemic. So I would like to make three points here regarding the China experience in using the digital health solutions in the context of COVID-19. So the first point is, we all understand applying digital information technology is essential in the combat against COVID-19. So these different IT information technologies are widely used in China. I will share one example. The health code is a smartphone application app. So China, every province, we developed their own health code system. They use three different color, red, green, yellow, to represent the level of risk. Using this system to decide an individual's risk of exposure by tracking their travel history and the time they spend in high risk area. So as I said, every province developed their own system, but the different provinces we have mutually recognized each other. And recently, we can also use the health code to check whether a person has taken the vaccination against COVID-19 or not. Whenever you take an injection of a vaccine of COVID-19, so the information will automatically uploaded to the health code system. So using this to check the vaccination status. And the second point I want to make is, during the pandemic, many people encountered their specific barriers to use normal medical services. So especially for those who have chronic diseases, they need regular, normal visit to a doctor. So the pandemic had brought some barriers to them. So internet-based medical services, so in this context, become more popular in China. Some statistics shows that number of patients consulting a doctor online has increased more than 10 times during the pandemic than before. And also in the recent years, the Chinese government, the national government, has issued a few national policies to encourage the development of internet-based medical services. So of course, as the previous presenter has discussed, we understand the internet-based medical services have both the advantages of convenience, but also it has the disadvantages of some quality concerns. And the last point and third point I would like to make is, so in using this information technology, its digital health solutions, either to combat the pandemic itself or in using the routine health services, and we notice that some digital exclusions of older people, this is an ongoing global issue during the COVID-19 pandemic. Some survey that shows that the internet users of older people aged over 60 years old in China has doubled during the pandemic. In a few months' time, the users of the internet user of old people has doubled. But some senior citizens, they do not have access to internet, or mostly they need some help from their children or other family members to use the health code, as I said before, or other digital technologies. So we see there is a global issue on the digital divide between the older people and the young people. And bridging this digital divide between the older people and young people during the COVID-19 pandemic can also bring us with new opportunities, but also with major challenges. And this is the point I want to make. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Liu, and I totally agree that real-time face-to-face encounters, through the digital devices have become the new normal. And people are taking advantage of the fact, and if more and more health workers as well as, patients get used to the concept of this telemedicine, I think the virtual care will penetrate more deeper into the healthcare system. And it's very interesting to note that the elderly are learning and they are happy to go virtual. Otherwise, that section of they are not too keen on digital. They really want to meet the doctor and discuss their problems. But it's an interesting thing to note that elderly are also getting used to the fact of telemedicine and telehealth. Thank you so much. Okay. Now, if I may come back to Dr. Rafael, and I would specifically want you to let us know that being a public health analyst, how do you perceive that? What can the governments do, either singly or in partnership with multilateral or other stakeholders, to catalyze a digital transformation in global health? What do you suggest could be done?
Thank you, Mrs. Shuri. I think the first and more, let's say, obvious point is data sharing. Pretty much is to build national infrastructure or databases on information technology that allows us to, first, to not just to share data, but before that, we share pretty much the same type of data. I think some of the speakers, one of the speakers has mentioned that we need to standardize how information is collected, and we need to specific protocols and standardization of the information that is being collected in the countries so that we can share them and compare the information in terms of the volume and the quality of information that we have. This will help in many issues, such as the most obvious is surveillance. As I said, it's being done for quite a while in Brazil, and we are now going through the process of investing in continued investment in infrastructure, which is, by the way, I think one of the speakers has also mentioned this. Continued investing in infrastructure is the second point. We sometimes have, let's say, specific periods, at least in Brazil, in which we have huge volumes of investment in infrastructure, be it information technology in a broader sense, or the most important, access to internet and training of health professionals, which is also important. Professor Liu has mentioned the issue of old people using internet, but we also have another problem in Brazil. Most of the health professionals are not yet trained to the new technologies, which is also important. And this may be an issue in maybe all the countries, be them physicians, psychologists, dentists, or any other nurses, midwives, or any other health professionals. So wrapping up and answering directly your question. First, standardize how information is collected and processed in the countries. Secondly, making the information available, not only at the multilateral levels, but as Professor Natalia has mentioned, national health systems cannot do it alone. We also need to rely on entrepreneurs, on startups, on the private sector, and any other actors that can help transforming the data into effective intelligence and services to the populations. And thirdly, continued investment in infrastructure and all other aspects of health technology. So these are the three points I wanted to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rafael. If I may go on to Professor Natalia. If you can tell us, how can digital technology accelerate or optimize the healthcare services without actually exacerbating the digital divide? How you think that this could actually optimize the healthcare system? What could be the digital health solution to optimize the healthcare system? Professor Natalia?
I suppose what the big achievements now, what we can upload data regarding PCR testing from returning travelers and information about vaccination in government system. And in this system, everybody can see their own result of PCR testing, because sometimes laboratory upload by itself this analysis in this system. And also everybody can reach their certificate regarding vaccination. It was started maybe 6 or more months ago when we start implement widely vaccination. And several months before, we start to upload all information in our government system, and also based on China experience, this government system allow to keep in home, for example, contact person, person who returned from abroad, because this system monitor movement of people via mobile phones according to GPS coordinates. And also the big achievements, recent big achievements, that is collections all sequence data in one database, which allow to monitor distribution of different mutation in all whole territory of Russia. And I can say what we now have not any Indian mutation. We have very low amounts of Britain strain and strain, an African strain. And we did not detect Brazilian strain, as I know. And I think it is achievements can received using contact tracing and very, very strong system for testing people who return from other countries to Russia. Over.
Thank you, Professor Natalia. And I think I agree with Dr. Rafael as well as you that, you know, transparency of data and standardizing information is very important so that we actually have a clear picture of what is the damage and what is can be more done to rectify it. If I can go over to Professor Liu, if you can tell us that how the multilateral platforms like our, you know, BRICS and we have the other platforms as well, how can they utilize, you know, to enhance, how can the multilateral platforms utilize to enhance knowledge, sharing and technology partnerships to tackle any future health emergencies? What could they do? And how could they use the knowledge to actually be able to overcome any of the future emergencies, global health emergencies?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the question. I think this platform, like this BRICS countries platform is very, I mean, it's very helpful and useful. The panel discussion tonight is a very good example of the value of this kind of discussion. So I think, as the first the Brazil colleague noticed very beginning, every country has their own health system, very unique health system. So I think sharing this kind of knowledge, because in the digital health solutions, they have innovations every day. This is the area has the most innovations every day. So I think using this kind of reform, this kind of platform, we can share our different experiences, innovations. But this information, this experience, may only be applicable in our own context. So I think the colleagues here, this platform can help when we take message, we take the experience from other countries, the national team can use this information to transform them into the national context to for example, the right policy. For us, we mostly use we have the international lessons learned. We transform them into a policy brief, for example, using the China's specific context, the style of our policy brief to transfer to the national government policymakers. So I think this is because some technologies can maybe only be useful in one context. If you repeat them in a different context, they might be have different effects. So I think using the national team, but gathering the information from this platform, I think that will be very useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Liu. I totally agree that how this information from these platforms can be transferred and adapted into our own national strategy, that could be something which all countries can learn from. Coming over to Dr. Shambhavi, you are a public policy person. So if I can just ask you, what are the health policy and privacy challenges associated with digital technology? If you can throw some light on it. You're on mute.
This better?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks for the question, Dr. Suri. I think the first and foremost policy problem that I see is that we take a blanket one-size-fits-all approach when it comes to health policy, particularly when it comes to digital health. And I don't think that works in a country as complex as ours. So if you just look at vaccine deployment, for example, COVID might work in an urban area. There are areas where you have SMS and there are areas where the ASHA worker just has to go because you don't even have telephone coverage in those areas. I come from a village where that is the case, where the ASHA worker actually has to come every 15 days and make lists of people to be vaccinated. So that I think is a big policy hurdle. Second is public engagement. I think we just need to ramp up the engagement that we have done over healthcare technologies, and particularly if we want more digital health to be adopted. Third is in terms of infrastructure itself, and not just health infrastructure, but also digital infrastructure. I mean, if we see that digital health is going to be the new healthcare of the new century, then we have to simply invest in both. In upgrading both infrastructures, right? The idea that 50% of Indians do not have access has to become archaic very soon. That's the third one. The fourth, from a policy point of view, I think the new idea of this sandboxes is really great. But again, that health regulator needs to bring in more confidence. So the idea of the shared health sandbox is that we will have this unique space to test out new technologies under the oversight of an ambassador, of a regulator. But we need to have a strong regulator that builds confidence. And I think last for me as a policy hurdle for digital health is funding and the inclusion of startups and new technologies and opening up reducing barriers for bringing in new technologies from outside into India and allowing them to thrive. I think these five for me are big policy hurdles that we need to overcome.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Shambhavi. I totally agree that, it could not be one policy or one solution that fits all. And specifically in countries where the reach is very difficult and then people do have a problem in accessing the internet. And then we are looking at digital solutions that also needs to be kept in mind when we are working out strategies of how we can reach to the last mile. So that should be more important. Okay, so now I have a few questions, and I can specifically any one of you can go for it. I would really like to know. There's a question like, how can technologies associated with the fourth IR be adapted and developed to positively impact the provision and the access to healthcare? Now we have these vaccination drives happening. We use the Internet of Things to, you know, work on how everybody can have access. So that's the latest example which is going on. If any of you would like to, tell us know how in your countries, basically these technologies associated have been adapted to positively impact on healthcare. Professor Natalia or Dr. Rafael, if you would like to throw some light on it.
No, I only can show one example now in more outpatients department in Russia, especially, for example, in Moscow and St. Petersburg, it is possible to make electronic on vaccination or for on doctor, on visit to doctor. It is very easy and also available via government system, appointment to polyclinics and appointment to general practitioners for many neuro specialists and also appointment for vaccination.
Yeah, it's easier to reach out to the healthcare professionals.
Yeah, it is allow to people avoid long tail waiting, for example, in polyclinics, which can lead to spread of virus or other diseases. And also during this year, we start to implement electronic access to computer tomography. For example, now computer tomograph working in many healthcare establishment 24 hours per day, and in these cabinets working usually only nurse assistant of physicians, and all the data go to electronic cloud, and physician sitting, for example, at home or in another office can view and analyze of computer tomography. It is only like a second example.
Thank you, Professor. Dr. Rafael, would you like to?
Yes, just complimenting. I mentioned in my opening remarks that we have a very different health system. So equity and access to healthcare is not optional in Brazil. It's a constitutional matter. The state must provide. So and this is the main reason why I mentioned telemedicine. But the platform that is actually being built in Brazil comprises pretty much everything. You have all access to the clinical records. You can make appointments in any primary healthcare center or specialized health specialized units in the country. You can schedule, for example, your vaccine, your immunization. You can check which physicians and when they are available in your city, and many other functionalities. It is important to say that, as I think Professor Shambhavi mentioned, that in the one hand, we are working with blockchain technology, artificial intelligence, but we also have to live with the fact that many Brazilians, they don't have access even to internet or to a personal computer. So we have to live with both. I think answering your question directly, we have to balance between the use and application of the newest technologies available to process data and try to actually extract intelligence from it for health workers and health managers and obviously the user. But at the other hand, we still have to rely on traditional forms of managing and providing healthcare. So this is pretty much the situation we have in Brazil. So far, I think Professor Liu mentioned, and Professor Shambhavi as well, mentioned that there is no one-size-fits-all approach because we all have different health systems. But we, and this is a proposal, I think Professor Liu mentioned that, we can also rely on policy briefs so that we can get to know each other better and try to find areas of convergence where we can cooperate and still share best practices and reflect on how they can be implemented in our countries. In this regard, Brazil already has some case studies on the digital health strategy in this context. that I have just mentioned. So that's it for my intervention. Thank you.
Thank you. I think, yes, some of the best practices which could be scaled up in a similar kind of a setting could be a good example, especially for the BRICS nations, as well as, you know, some of the developing countries who would like to take it up. I would like to ask Professor Liu, what do you think are the infrastructural changes that could be made in the direction to ensure that the same kind of a scenario in the future can be dealt with more effectively and more efficiently? What could be the infrastructural changes?
Okay, thank you. I think again, I've given some experience with China's experience on how to deliver the normal health services during the pandemic. For example, I mean, we use more and more online services. For example, usually people, they go to the hospital to make an appointment in the clinic or in the hospital. Now, during the pandemic, so we set up the infrastructure on online system so people can make the appointment online and they only go to the hospital to see the doctor. So spend less time in the hospital, in the clinic to avoid some getting the infection. But then in the pandemic, more and more companies, they say this is a market opportunity to set up an online hospital. And the government, we have set up a new regulations to say, if you want to provide the online services, you have to have a real hospital as a base. You cannot only set up an online hospital. One doctor can set up an online hospital. So they need to have a real hospital to support the online services. I think this is another system we have so far. And then for some old people and with, especially for those with chronic diseases, I mean, some primary healthcare system, we develop the home delivery services. So for the health workers can deliver the medicine they need, the pharmaceutical product they need to their home if they are inconvenient to come to the hospital. I think this kind of system, it's not a very systematic analysis of the infrastructure, but just a few examples we have so far to support the normal health services and the also in the pandemic era. Over.
Thank you, Professor Liu. Dr. Shambhavi, would you like to add that with some India experience?
I think I will just end up reiterating what I've been saying so far. We need to ramp up digital infrastructure and health infrastructure in preparation for future such scenarios. We need a clear course of public engagement action, which I think we kind of could have done better this time around as well. We need to build up stockpiles of necessary, it could be PPEs, it could be ventilators. There's a list, it definitely would be oxygen at this point of time. So we need to have a list of those essential things and stockpiles. We need to invest more in vaccine research and vaccine manufacturing. I think that's one thing that we have the expertise in and we need to leverage that much better. So that will be my additional points.
I totally agree. I mean, the first point on ramping up the health infrastructure, which kind of came crumbling because of this sudden pandemic, I think even to avoid anything in the future, there is a need to, ramp up the health system. And yes, stockpile of important, at least medical equipments and drugs, which would be needed to avoid such a kind of a panic situation. I have one last question from the audience. I have asked it in a different way, but I would just like to ask that whether how to, what are the efforts to mitigate cyber threats if there should be any training given to the health institutions for the same. So if you could throw some light on it, probably we'll start with Dr. Shambhavi.
Well, I'm neither a public health expert nor a cybersecurity expert, so I'll just start with that disclaimer. My understanding is that there is a fine line between security and privacy, and we sometimes get confused between those two when it comes to data. I think our current NDHM blueprint and the DEPA architecture, which I mentioned about, relies very heavily on protecting privacy. It has the idea of consent managers who are required to officially transfer data from the patient to a health facility or vice versa. But I don't think we have given adequate emphasis on cybersecurity of the data per se. I think at this point of time, hospitals tend to spend very low amounts on cybersecurity as well as compared to more IT educated sectors. And I think that needs to change. I agree with the idea that we need that stakeholder in all of our discussions when it comes to creating a digital health tool.
Professor Liu, if you can throw some light on the cybersecurity issue.
Okay, I think this is a very important issue. I mean, especially when more and more people using the internet, using the online services, the privacy and ethical issues associated with the use of digital health data is a very big concern. In China, we have the same. I mean, I've mentioned the old people, especially for the old people. I mean, they are usually the target of the, we call it, telecommunication fraud. So being afraid of this kind of fraud, some old people are not, they don't like to use the online technologies. So I think this, we need combined efforts to do that. First, on the government perspective, I think what we need to do is, I feel we need to strengthen the regulation, the legislation system, to when we find any these kind of unethical practices, need to have you using the law to protect the people. And the of course the technology providers, they can upgrade their system to support the people. And finally, we may also to support the, I mean, I make some focus on the old people, on the senior citizens, to improve their internet literacy, their competence in using these kind of services. So I think we need combined efforts to secure this problem. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Liu. Last, I would like to come back to Dr. Rafael, and we would like to know that the recent patent waiver will it be able to prove a counter deterrence against the brutality that the pandemic has caused in the world? Do you think it will make a difference?
You mean the patent for the vaccine? I'm sorry, because my internet.
Yeah, the
internet
patent waiver.
Is not,
yes,
the best at this moment. Sorry. Okay. Definitely. Unfortunately, I'm going to give you my personal opinion, because on this issue, I think the Brazilian government has its own opinion on how the issue should go. But in my opinion, the short answer is yes, definitely. We need to share as much as possible. We had examples in the past with other diseases in which we have cooperated, and at a global scale, we have been able to control. I'll not elaborate more, because this is a question of yes and no. So yes, definitely. And would you mind if I elaborated a little bit more on your last question, because it was excellent on cybersecurity? Do you have time? Maybe a couple of minutes?
Yes, sure. Yes, Dr. Rafael.
This is an excellent question. We are still lagging a lot behind in Brazil. In health, we do have a specific institution which is 100% dedicated to the health infrastructure and data processing, which is called DataSUS, Data NHS in other words. But we still lack professionals and specific training on security related matters. The data protection law is quite new in Brazil, and it has been issued a couple of years ago. It was a huge debate in Brazil. We are still not exactly implementing the law as it should be, but we have been experiencing a lot of advances in especially individual data protection. This is a huge issue when it comes to clinical data of patients, for example. And one thing that I also wanted to mention is that digital health is an issue in Brazil, but we are digitizing almost all other public policies at the federal level and state levels. So we drew a lot from the United Kingdom experience, gov.uk. So everything that the state provides in Brazil will be found in one single place, gov.br. And all the initiatives related to health will be also attached to this unique entry point, which is 100% user-centered. And as Professor Shambhavi has mentioned, in almost all the time she spoke today, we cannot do it alone. It's a huge effort. The state itself and any government or state itself cannot do it alone and process all this data and take intelligence and provide high-quality medical services. We need to rely on other actors, either multilaterally, like we are doing here today, or the private or the civil society with startups and new energy from people that do understand how to process data. And to finalize my comment, also disclaimer, I'm a data analyst, not exactly a cybersecurity expert. So this is my personal view. Thank you.
I totally agree. It needs to be a collective effort if we need to reach our goal of good health and well-being. Now, I would request all of you to give a final remark on this idea of digital health solution for the digital transformation in global health. If I could have a final remark or final word from all of you, maybe we start with Professor Natalia. If we can have a final word. Remark on this.
Thank you very much. I very enjoy our meeting because we can have here possibility to exchange our experience, to change the experience of country. And I think that first of all, we should continue to develop our healthcare service from education of our citizens, from young to old, and to ensure health environment, which also will keep our citizens to be healthy. And of course, we need to use new technology in our health service, IT technologies, to develop different neural nets for achievement not only national data, but also international, because only together we can find the solution and achieve a good health on global level. Thank you very much for all.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. Professor Liu?
Yes, thank you. I also very enjoy this discussion very much. I think this topic is very important, and in the future, I think digital health solution will be becoming even more important in the future. So I think this is a very important topic we have discussed. So I think although the different countries, we have all used digital health technologies to improve our services, but I think we need to keep in mind the equity issues. I mean, the equity using the service of digital health solutions may enlarge the inequity between countries and within countries. I hope we can work together through globally and also within the national government to work to ensure that the service, the benefit of digital health solution will bring the benefit to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Dr. Shambhavi?
Thanks, Dr. Suri. I just have one comment, which is we just have to do this together. It's in the shared interest of the BRICS nation to develop digital health tools. And as an example, I just wanted to take that last audience question of the IP waiver for vaccines. It's a great start, but is incomplete and won't be successful unless we have IP waivers on the technical know-how as well as the consumables that go into vaccines. And this was first put in a proposal by India and South Africa together. So obviously, there is stuff that we can do together, and the continued push from the BRICS countries can actually be a great way to show the world what we can do together and make sure that global health interests are protected. Thank you.
We'll all need to together adapt and responsive for the change. So I think that's a good way of what you have said. I totally agree. Dr. Rafael?
The last word,
then we close.
Okay, really quickly, I would like to endorse what Professor Liu has said. We cannot move forward with digital health without ensuring equity and access to everybody. This is a very important point for us in Brazil. And secondly, as I mentioned twice, we cannot do it alone. We need to be open to cooperation. And these are my last words, equity and cooperation. This is the message I'd like to this is what I would like to leave as a last message. Thank you very much.